today, I'm going to be here this evening, I'll be traveling home tonight. So we are always looking for some new young blood and to help us develop and promote survey, not just in Norway, but I suppose in Northern Europe. So yeah, it would be good to hear from anybody. So a little bit about what we've got planned for the rest of the year with NOSP. Obviously this event does take up quite a bit of planning. It has gone extremely well all the way up until Friday, where I had a couple of cancellations, but it's certainly, certainly grateful for one company in particular for turning up today, and will no doubt deliver the goods. So in October, we're back in Bergen. We're going to hopefully get some students involved, and they're going to present some of their bachelor's and their master grads. And yeah, I'm looking forward to that. I think it's really important that we do increase the amount of students that are involved in us and in the general survey field. We're all struggling to fill that gap of skilled surveyors within the business at the moment. So we feel obliged to do our bit. So hopefully this is a springboard for some students to join the business. And then of course for the highlight of the year for everybody, I have no question, no doubt that that's the case. The annual dinner, end of the month in November, a raucous affair. It was violent last year, it was extremely good. I enjoyed it a lot, and I think a lot of you guys did. We were at a new location this year. We thought we'd mix it up a bit. The other location was quite good, but it's always going to change as good as the rest. So we're at the Stavanger Concert House, Restad, and hopefully Equinor. Equinor not confirmed, but hopefully that they will provide an overview survey. And then we've got some non-work related presentations that I'm hoping will be quite entertaining for you. And then we'll be putting out the dates for next year. So yeah, a little bit about today's presentations. Very, very high quality presentations in my mind, based around remote and autonomous. It's the buzzwords of the time. So to have all these companies presenting with these titles, I think we're all in for a very entertaining day. We're going to kick off in a minute with Ed, Al Ronson. I'm not even sure he's even here yet, but we're going to drop Al down to the bottom of the pecking order. So Ed's going to kick things off. I think this is a very high quality, probably one of the highest quality presentation or agendas that I've seen at a NOSP event. So I'd like to extend my thanks to all the companies, especially Kongsberg, who stepped in at the last minute. And I think Kongsberg's presentation will be very entertaining. So that's it from me, really. I would like you just to enjoy the day. I will just have a quick mention, because I can actually do this. I mean, I work at DOF Subsea. I've got some colleagues from overseas here, from Perth, Houston, and Rio. They are sat on that table over there. Have a chat to them. They don't bite. Well, Ray does a little bit. That's his Scottish blood, so that's an excuse. But yeah, there's a lot of people from all over the world here, so enjoy the day, and yeah, that's it for me. And we'll welcome Ed to the stage. Are you presenting on your own? Okay. Okay, I thought we had a co-conspirator, but not now.
Super. Set to Viking height. How about that? You hear me? Good. Thanks. Okay, well, thanks very much, everyone, for the invite to speak this afternoon. My title is Autonomy, the Future is Now. So in the next 25 minutes, I'm going to discuss how advances in sensor technology, communications, and computational power are bringing enhanced capabilities to remote and autonomous surveys. Future is now. Space. Teledyne is no stranger to taking on challenging remote sensing applications with no distance too far to travel, as evidenced by the Perseverance rover currently searching for life on Mars 375 million kilometers away. The rover will characterize the planet's geology and past climate, pave the way for human exploration of the Red Planet, and it will be the first mission to collect and cache Martian rock and dust. Perseverance, like its predecessors, Curiosity and Spirit, is covered in sensors from my employer, Teledyne, and it's also powered by a thermoelectric nuclear generator from Teledyne Energy Systems. And in fact, when NASA successfully landed Perseverance on the surface of Mars on the 18th of February 2021, footage of its entry, descent, and landing was captured from multiple angles and broadcast live using no fewer than 6 machine cameras from Teledyne FLIR. Taking 7 minutes for the images to reach Earth, the team on the ground referred to this as the 7 minutes of terror, because they had no idea whether it had already exploded, had it failed, had it crashed, and so they were watching live these 7 minutes, worrying, watching, waiting, hoping. And I'd like to share with you this morning, or this afternoon, rather, a brief video of the very moment where their minds were set at ease.
Mission track speed is about 30 meters per second, altitude about 300 meters off the surface of Mars. We have started our constant velocity accordion, which means we are conducting a five plane, about to conduct a five plane maneuver. Tracking the neighborhood started, about 20 meters off the surface.
Looking at signals from MRO.
Tango Delta.
Tesla confirmed. Perseverance, take away on the surface of Mars, ready to begin taking the sand of pathway.
And I love the dad dancing for the guy in there. On the right there. Fantastic. Looking further out into our universe, the James Webb Space Telescope has recently been capturing some stunning images that we've seen in the media of deep space, and it's using near-infrared imaging sensors from Teledyne Scientific. These are bringing deep space to life like never before, revealing previously undetected galaxies, some so remote that their very faint light has taken 13.4 billion years just to travel to Earth. At a distance of 6,000, hang on, I missed one. It disappeared. The slide does not match the notes. How did that happen? Well, let's not worry about that, shall we? A little closer to Earth is this one.
Yeah.
That one. Oh! Pointing back at our blue planet and situated just 400 kilometers away, the International Space Station plays host to MUSIS, which is the multi-user system for Earth sensing, built and operated by Teledyne and managed from Teledyne Brown's headquarters in Huntsville, Alabama. But back on Earth, Teledyne is just as actively involved in remote sensing at both a platform and a technology level for third-party integration. Not shown here. What's happened to my slides? Who's messed with these? Shown here is a UGV. And we see it twice for some reason. It should show us the Black Hornet on the left here, which is a small, tiny helicopter drone made in Oslo, Norway. I don't know if you're familiar with this. It fits inside your pocket, and you can take it out, and it will fly. And troops are using it to see beyond the horizon what's going on into the building ahead. Fire departments are using it to rescue people. You can't squeeze in through the door yet, but there's a gap. Let's put it in. Can we save someone in an earthquake situation? That's the Black Hornet drone. This UGV, by contrast, is doing another important job, taking man one step back from danger, putting the robot in to see what's going on around the corner and possibly to deal with the situation. So Teledyne are well known across an array of industries for applications that are quite diverse when it comes to imaging. Our strapline everywhere you look. And I just wanted to set the stage here a little bit as we talk about our industry and some of the challenges that we face, because there is commonality here with what's happening elsewhere. I saw this week firsthand some infrared technology being used by Teledyne. Teledyne were offshore Europe. We were selling handheld infrared systems for gas detection. I was away camping recently and I bought a pizza with my friend, and we were sitting having a chat. He was a fireman in Aberdeen. He starts asking me about my work. And then he lit up and he said, Teledyne. He said, you're the guys that make our handhelds for the thermal imaging before we go into a room. What's the temperature through that door? They're using that. And I have no idea why it's coming up twice. We're also known for our associated analytics, with machine vision technology being used in a variety of advanced driver assist and autonomous vehicle systems. I like this image here. It shows how far we've come. Machine vision, machine learning, being taught to spot a motorbike, to being taught to spot a pedestrian. And will we put our trust in these? We're starting to. But what about this image here? At first glance, it looks pretty good. What about the two motorbikes there it's missed? What about the person that it's missed there? And humans are fallible too. My wife hit a gatepost not so long ago. She didn't see, she swore it wasn't there, but it was, and that's not a sexist joke. She's just a bad driver. But we've come a long way, and there's a lot further, I think, still to come. And this next video from Boston Robotics, I think, shows how far we've come over the last 40 years. Thankfully, I restrained for everyone's benefit. Machine learning is on the rise, though, and the rate of acceleration is tangible. It's noticeable. 10 years ago, for my birthday, my wife, who actually is an excellent driver, organized a real treat for me. And that was to visit the Smithsonian National Air and Space Museum just outside Washington, D.C. in Dulles. And if you're ever passing that way, I would thoroughly recommend it, if you like airplanes. I like airplanes. Amazing place, all kinds of flying machines there. There are Spitfires, there are biplanes, there are Boeings, Doodlebugs, V-Rockets. It's incredible. The Enola Gay is there, which on August 6, 1945, brought about the end of World War II, or the beginning of the end, when it bombed Hiroshima, Japan, tragically wiping out three quarters of the city in an instant. There was a space shuttle. Just sharing my holiday photos. There was a Concorde, which, like the Channel Tunnel, is evidence that the French and the English can collaborate when we really want to. There is also carefully preserved the Wright Flyer. It's the product of a sophisticated four-year R&D program conducted by Wilbur and Orville Wright, beginning in 1899. After building and testing three full-size gliders, the Wright's first powered airplane flew at Kitty Hawk, North Carolina on December the 17th, 1903, making a 12-second flight, traveling just 36 meters with Orville piloting. The best flight of the day with Wilbur at the controls covered 255.6 meters in 59 seconds. Then there's the S-71 Blackbird, capable of traveling at three times the speed of sound. But as I walked around enjoying all of these airplanes and all of this technology, there was a thought that struck me. And that is that just 60 years before, using canvas and wooden struts, a 1 minute flight spanning 250 meters led to this. Thanks to hundreds of thousands of engineers sharing information and building upon those early principles, we went from wondering if we could fly to flying at Mach 3 in a machine that to this day brings any red-blooded pilot goosebumps, just thinking about it, 60 years. And I believe the same is happening in AI. And the reason for this rapid acceleration is not the fruit of any particular lab or isolated group of engineers, but rather the result of open source code from companies like Microsoft, Amazon, Meta, being turned over to hundreds of thousands of clever engineers worldwide who collectively shall and are driving forward what is possible, even machines being taught to write code. So can we harness such resources to enhance the capabilities of sensor technology associated with remote and autonomous maritime platforms? Well, the answer is yes, of course we can. Resounding yes. An obvious example is in collision avoidance, where algorithms built around electro-optical and infrared cameras, such as these ones from Teledyne FLIR, can be used not only to give situational awareness, but also to allow computer algorithms to identify targets themselves and make decisions on the best course of action for the vessel in the event of a potential collision. But what about hydrography? How do we use advanced detection capabilities, smart algorithms, and new architectures to improve the quality of the data that we collect? Well, in Teledyne Rizon's case, the first thing we had to do was to shrink our architecture to better suit smaller platforms. Wow, this is like a sort of Rubik's Cube. Photos are all getting moved around somehow. So if you all would crane your heads to the right, you'll see the small processor that we've designed for the seabat range of multibeams. Outside today, it's built into the maritime robotics vehicle that we're showing. But we can also put it in other small vehicles, including underwater vehicles like the Teledyne Gavia. So having shrunk this technology down, we're using it in these platforms. This was what we did yesterday. We went out, we had some fun with this robot boat, very quick to build and assemble outside. I'd heard that in the brochures. We experienced it in real life as we took the Pelican cases out and built ourselves an Otter with a T51 multi-beam. This is a 800 kilohertz full swap multi-beam with quarter by quarter degree beam footprint, so it gives really good resolution. And we couldn't resist going to map the harbor. Asking for local knowledge from RTS, we were very disappointed to learn that they've recently done a cleanup in the harbor with staff volunteering to go in and scuba and take every tire and every Coke can and beer can, apparently, out of the harbor. But we do still see some interesting features. We see some rocks that have been left there. We can see a pipe or a cable potentially coming across the bay. And there was rumors, there were very strong rumors of pirate treasure at the far side, an old shipwreck that no one knew much about. So we had to go there. So firstly, here's this cable. And thanks to Sjur Sivertsen, I hope I said your name roughly, not too awfully, we had a video and we were able to take a series of stills actually from that video to ground truth what's down there. And here is our cable bundle, I think it is, with maybe some small clamps. That's what we're detecting. So it's really quite tiny and we're getting some really nice 800 kilohertz data on that target. Oh, I was meant to click again. This data is completely uncleaned. It's just as it comes off the multi-beam, which is another feature that we like to talk about. The reason multi-beams, they are incredibly inherently clean. Next, the wreck itself. Sadly, no treasure chests found, but nice clean edges and sharp detail from this single pass across the wreck. And for those who haven't seen it already, please come join us at Maritime Robotics, are broadcasting live from their vehicle onto the booth. We'll go down to the water and enjoy the sun. But it's not just resolution and data quality which users require to get the most out of their autonomous platforms and remote platforms. To optimize results from these platforms, you need a sonar that knows how to drive itself, which is precisely what Rezon's advanced tracker is designed to do. Using adaptive gates to find and follow challenging seabed topography, the sonar chooses its settings automatically, adjusting ranges and gains to optimize ping rate accordingly. In short, at Teledyne, we've developed a sonar which runs itself. And that's incredibly important, increasingly important as we go remote, as we go autonomous, or even yesterday, they could have changed the settings if they wanted from the laptop at the water side, but it was blinding in the sun, you could barely see the screen. And we have a new vertical detection mode coming in our next release, which uses this same tracker, or a variant of the tracker, to track vertical structures such as this key wall. And it's some beautiful data here with the anodes below, one of them coming off the wall. And you can also see the anodes between the sheet pile here. But won't all this changing of settings by the sonar itself affect the quality of the backscatter, I hear you ask? There's always one. Well, that's an unusual picture. That's a surprising one. It's sort of a bit of a Russian roulette what you're going to get. No is the answer. And I've got a really nice example that I can show you at the booth afterwards that ought to be on the next slide. So instead, I've got a picture of the Odin, which is our test boat in Denmark. There's the Odin, ladies and gentlemen. Come to Denmark sometime. We'll take you out. There's another question here. There's another question. Throws you when the wrong image comes up. This means consistent results from backscatter, allowing the user to acquire optimal backscatter information without compromising bathymetry data. So we have a normalized backscatter routine that gives high fidelity seabed imagery that isn't impacted by sonar setting changes. So the sonar is changing its settings, but the backscatter is completely unaffected. But what about machine learning? Where does that fit in? Well, early stages, but we've had, in fact, a team of 7 people working specifically on AI for the past 2 years, and we expect rapid growth in both automated target recognition and data processing. We think that's going to be the fruit to our sensors, smarter sensors. Here, the first fruit of some of these endeavors, an automated detection routine we've been working on as an operator aid for our 7123 Mark II. This is a large, forward-looking mine-hunting sonar. And the circular target that's shown is a candidate mine-like object being identified by the sonar. The square one, also highlighted in the zoom window, is a confirmed target being tracked in range. So in addition to the tracker itself, there's a couple of other things that are going on here that I wanted to show you. So I just pulled up a couple of data examples. One is image stabilization. So what we're doing here is we're stabilizing the image by stacking pings. And we're taking out the systemic noise. It can appear in one ping, it's gone in the next, it's just random noise. And you get a much clearer, much more stable image, allowing either human or computer to see more clearly what's going on. And the next one is beam normalization. And this messes a little bit with some people's minds, because we're used to seeing a target of a certain strength close to the sonar head, exhibiting a bright return. And that same target, if it's further away, will give a lesser return. But what we're doing here is we're actually normalizing across the beam. So we're compensating for the range to target base differences by evening out the image and amplifying far away weak signals while dampening down those that are closer to the sonar head. And I think some of these things that are being used for mine hunting, for UXO, I think that you'll see them toggle across also into other smart algorithms. Teledyne Geospatial 2 are pouring efforts into machine learning, and Trish Buxton is here at the back and is looking forward to conversing with anyone who wants to chat about this at the break. A couple of examples we see here on the left is a noise classifier in Teledyne Caris. Our multi-beams are exceptionally clean, but not all are. So if you've got noisy data and you need it to be clean, we've got automated algorithms based on machine learning that will remove noise, and also from LiDAR too, teleangiospatial make the Optech brand of lasers. And actually what we see on the right here is a laser data set. And this is another machine learning algorithm that is classifying what is land and what is water in this delta region of a river. Well, that's another nice image. Look at that one. And then it exits. So, ladies and gentlemen, thank you very much for your time. The future is now.
I think full credit to Ed here for doing a really grand job. Actually, I wonder where he was going at the start of it, but it, given the gremlins, you've done very well. Let's just try and take this. I have another microphone.
Hello. That's not working.
So what I would just like to say thank you to Ed. That was really good. Does anybody have any questions for Ed, though? Is this working? Yeah, this is working. Okay. Right, 135 odd people in the room, and someone must have a question for Ed. That was a very interesting presentation. Anyone? Bueller? Okay. All right, Ed, I think what we'll do is before the next presentation, we're just going to check. That was there were some gremlins in the mix here. We need to grab iron that out. Just give you 5 to 10 minutes. Go and enjoy yourselves, grab a cup of coffee, talk to some people. Like I said, I've got some colleagues from all over the world here. Go and talk to become familiar, network. We'll come back in about 5 to 10 minutes. Thank you very much.
Sorry, check. Did my presentation become corrupt somehow? It's really weird. It's just odd. Something happened to the presentation, and it's like 2 or 3 of the slides suddenly went wrong. That should not be there. Where's my image gone? I've never seen that. It's my presentation is corrupt, but I don't know how it happened. Like I literally went through it again and again and again. Everything was good, and I saved it, and I checked it, and I started it, and then something really weird happened. Super weird.
places around the world at the moment. He's going to be talking about this a USB solution for the future. Thank you very much, Adrian.
Thanks, and thanks, Ed. That was difficult to follow on from his. It was kind of out of the world. So, I guess we, as we know, USVs are the hot topic at the moment, and pretty much everybody is either planning on getting a USV or is already running a small USV. And we at UTech are no different, except perhaps we've put a lot of effort in making sure that our USV is environmentally sustainable, environmentally friendly, and we hope that we've developed some features which are future-proof it in the medium term. But before I go on and talk about the USV, I'm just going to have a quick little introduction to our company. We're part of the larger Acteon group, and Acteon is made up of roughly 20 companies that we see over there. I think some of the names might be familiar to people here in Norway. I'm going to put up the little pointer so it works. You can see Claxton. Yeah, we got Claxton on that side. We've also got Intermore. That's also a company down in Stavanger. Being here in RTS, we might know equipment supplying company, Seatronics. But UTech, who I'm part of, is under this, the geoservices subgroup of Acteon. We are the lead partner, or the lead business in this grouping of three. We are performing services in the survey industry for, I think it's about 2000, I think, is when we've all been integrated. In total, let's move on to that. See, those three, there we go. So those three Acteon companies have been focusing on geophysical survey, geotechnical. We also do construction support. And with our key sort of turnkey solutions, we help our clients with designing their infrastructures and installation. A few statistics down there. The geoservices group is, I think, it's roughly a little bit more than 200 people at the moment. We spread over three general geographic locations. So we've got the Americas, in the USA, we've got those two other partners. And then in Europe and Africa, in Norway, in Stavanger, there's UTech, and then across in Aberdeen and Livingston, we've got another UTech offices. And then we've also got our other global division in the Pacific and Asia. But Acteon, and in particular the geoservices division, has got in together with a company called RC Docs in Imuru. And there was a plan to develop the USV, which was initially targeted at balance of plant visual video inspection and geophysical surveys. USV is, it's got a name, it's Marip, but I think we're just going to, it stands for Marine Autonomous Robotic Intervention Platform, and I think we'll just call it the UTech USV. It's, as you can see over there, it's 12 meters long, it's a catamaran, so it's quite wide, 6 meters, a 9 meter draft, and it's built to have quite DP maneuverability and position holding, position station keeping. They've built it with redundant systems on each of the pontoons, so the engine, the motor, the drive shaft, the batteries, the fuel, it's all in one pontoon. So if one of the pontoons gets damaged, I think it can be three quarters flooded and it'll still stay functional. So it can be regarded as DP2 equivalent, although we haven't registered as such. Those two 90 kilowatt engines that I told you about, they can drive the USV at around 10 knots and the transit speed. And at that transit speed, we can get around 2,600 nautical miles in a range. But mostly the time we're going to be using it in survey speeds, 5 knots, 7 knots. And then, of course, we'll have almost double the range on that, I assume. And then if we really are just hanging around in a wind farm in a loiter mode, no active survey, then endurance is about 27 days. Between the two pontoons, there's a platform, and on that platform we've got a remotely operated one. Of course, it's remotely, it's USB, but it's a winch, and we have the MVP, the SVP attached to that. It downloads data after a cast with Bluetooth, and the platform has a payload of 3 metric tons. We can use that to put it on ROVs, LARS, the HPU, and the ROV itself. And the ROV we're using, we've chosen to use the Vela ROV because, you'll see later I'll describe it. It is a very futuristic ROV or very advanced ROV, but it also comes from our sister company, Seatronics. Each of the pontoons has a moon pool, and in that moon pool is a retractable pole with a payload of 500 kilograms, and we can put multi-beam, dual-headed multi-beam, side scan sub-bottom. And on the other pole, we could have the USBL for the positioning. Or we could have ADCP, acoustic modem, as we see there, for downloading data from moorings and environmental sensors. The list is the usual that you would expect. So the benefits of having, let's see if this moves on. There we go. The key benefits of this setup that we have, as it says, it's a USB, so of course it's uncrewed. And I guess we all know the benefits there, HSE. There's no crew changes, so you don't have to bring the vessel alongside. Possible to scale the offline processing up and down. You don't always have a lot of processes on board. Client data gets delivered in near real-time support. We all know it. It's why we're all interested in USVs. But our USV, unlike many USVs, we can operate. It's possible to operate from a port without a mothership. Some ports require not necessarily a mothership, but just a support vessel. I'll get into that later. But it could operate with a mothership. So like many other smaller USVs that people are using now, in a force multiplier setup. So at the moment, currently, the 12 meter USV is one of the larger ones that's in the market. There are a lot of USVs that are being planned and are soon to be released. Reach is here as well, and they've got their Reach Remote, which is going to be larger. But ours is at around 12 meters. It's similar to the Fugro USV, which is also operation at the moment. But I think ours is a little bit, because it's it's a catamaran, it's a lot more stable. And the sort of average launch and recovery limit for the ROV is around 2 meters significant, maybe 2.5, I guess, depends on the period. I think that's probably a bit more stable than a single monohull like the Fluke one. The bigger ones will start coming soon, and they, of course, will be stable, but what's the benefit of the smaller ones, ones under 12 meters, is they can be containerized. So in, we can put the, we can separate the USV into three pieces and it goes into three 40-foot containers and can be delivered quite cheaply, economically to any part of the world. Once it's mobilized with the ROV and all the geophysical equipment that you choose to put on it, it's flexible. It can be swapping from one scope of work to the other. For instance, if it's maybe doing visual inspection and the current changes and the tide's not suitable, then we could quickly go off and do a few hours of geophysical and then return when the current direction is suitable again. Doesn't have to come alongside to be reconfigured or stand around waiting for the right time. So far, it's proved to be very reliable. It's got water jets, not propellers, so the thrusters are there because we got tethers in the water, and of course reduces the chance of us getting snagged in the fishing gear. And with, as you saw, the draft's not much, and with the multi-beam out on the pole, we'd be going down to 3 meters, so there could be things in the area that we want to avoid. Like any other USV, if you have your remote centers manned 24 hours a day, you can get 24/7 operations. There's no need to stop for crew changes. It just carries on. It's quite small, similar to any USV which is scaling down from a large traditional vessel, it's cost effective. It doesn't have a large carbon footprint. But it can also use biofuel, which is our efforts in being sustainable, and it's built with a renewable hull. Because from the beginning, when they started designing it, there was an emphasis on making sure that it was a sustainable, environmentally friendly USV. So it's been built with HD polyethylene. I think it was 10, yeah, it uses 1/10 of the amount of energy, so electricity, to melt it, to mold it as aluminium wood, which is commonly used in other hull designs. So there was a saving on the environmental cost to produce it. It's lightweight, so it uses less fuel. That's the, you know, polyethylene, but plastic is quite light. It uses less fuel. There's low maintenance. It's relatively robust, and it has quite a long life cycle, and that means the footprint is over the entire life cycle. It's quite low. And polyethylene is used to make plastic bags, bottle tops, toothpaste tubes. So it's something we know can be recycled, and the same with the USV. At the end of life, it can be recycled back in. There's benefits there. And no toxic antifouling paint is needed either. And the other important environmental consideration was that we had to have biofuel. And if we, with our chosen biofuel supplier, if it's able to deliver, then the biofuel is produced in a sustainable manner, and the transport is carefully chosen, so that when the USV uses the fuel, it's net zero carbon output. But that reduction in usage of fuel is common actually to all USVs because they are smaller. You don't need a large crewed vessel. The example, little image down here, is a typical vessel that would have maybe, say, about 16 to 20 people on board, the surveyors, the ROV, the client, and the marine crew as well. It has enough space for everybody, and it's got to put the ROV on, and that's, let's say, roughly a 50-meter size vessel, compared to the 12-meter little USV, which doesn't need all of that extra space. And we did a comparison. We checked the fuel burn in an hour with a little USV. Any USV will be about the same. around 30 litres, comparing that to the larger 50-litre vessel, which was almost 300 litres burned in an hour. So roughly 90% reduction in fuel consumption. And then calculating that reduction up, it's 51,000 kilograms of CO2 released in 75 hours of survey. And most larger geophysical surveys go on for weeks. So you can imagine it's really is a saving using smaller USVs. There's a real benefit to having. But a problem with the adoption of USVs at the moment, what's a hurdle with the USVs is to get them certified. We were actually approached which was very, very nice, Rena approached us and to ask if we would be there. They wanted to work with us and to see that we Rena is sort of similar to a DMV or a Lloyd's. They wanted to help us to make sure that our USV had all the features and had all the security and the safety to be, I have to speak up, I think, to be certified as a USV. So we were going to be their first customer. Should we swap it?
Yeah, I'm going to mute
your mic. Yeah, okay. Sure. Well, we were the first to be given the certification. It was an uncrewed vessel, or it's marine autonomous surface ship certificate. And that allows the USV to be used for the moment in 200 nautical miles from the coast, or, as I'll explain in a minute, is also can be crewed 30 nautical miles from the coast. It has a small station on the deck, and this is useful because if we're in a port where perhaps the port authority is not used to remotely operated operations, or it's very busy, or maybe we are worried about it, it's possible for us to have crew on board to bring the USV in and out of the port. And we've also got we've got a Dutch flag. I think we've been licensed as experimental craft. So that's helped us do a lot of our testing around in Ireland, in the Dutch sector. And we've also been investigating going to other, if we have to survey in other areas. The MCA, which has already given certification to other USVs, they think it'll be very easy for us to get certified seeing as we've already got our certification from RENA. And the same with Denmark is very good. They have a special team dedicated to smoothly integrating remote services in the marine industry. And the Belgian flag is also similar to the Dutch. They will easily give us an experimental license. But remotely operated vessels need good network, good internet connections. So this is a point where we think we've managed to future-proof ourselves or a good development, because UTEC has built its own, we call it the comms hub. This uses a sophisticated network protocol to give sort of end-to-end encrypted connection, which is the comms hub is able to find sort of like a Google Maps situation where it finds the tracks, what's the slowest route, it watches the packets, and then it decides the best route, and it also bonds many streams. So if you've got VSAT and 4G and Starlink, it will bond them all together, increase the output. And another, when we're in terrestrial, you usually got a very stable supply. But if you're swapping between maybe one drops out, maybe Starlink drops out on a traditional bonded system, it would really struggle while this smart networking is able to quickly and easily adjust to drops out of one of your data streams. So I think the other important, which I mentioned earlier, the other important future proof that we have is the ROV. That's from the Seatronics, the Vana ROV, versatile lightweight observation ROV. It's apparently one of the lightest ROVs in its class, but it has a payload, which they say is pretty good. It's 21 kilograms, and the system power is standard 20 kilowatts, but they can put a skid on it, which doubles that to 40 kilowatts. And yeah, in general, it's a ruggedized network switch, so it delivers lots of data. We can, as you can see, they're 40 gigabytes of bandwidth, and they can double that. So it is, as I said, it's future proof. When there's more sensors and there's more demand for more data, then it's quite easy to increase that to 40 gigabits and more ports. At the moment, it's got 5 user configurable ports, which can have Ethernet, of course, gigabit, serial, and power, and then there's also some other small I/O options as well. There's an embedded INS, and you can't see it on this figure I'll show you later, but there's also a small GPS receiver on the top. So it's when the INS spins up, it gets its position, and the software, the controlling software, uses this INS good. Users have said it's got excellent automatic features, so auto station key, auto heading, auto trim. Even though it's got very powerful thrusters, I think it's 100 or 98 kilograms barred hull. But even with all that power, the smart controlling software makes it quite easy to operate. As standard, it comes with two Gigi cameras, a color and a monochrome. But you can put other sensors on it as well. And here's a couple of examples or pictures as well of what can be put on. It's a small little 660 TSS. We've got some manipulators on the skid. There's a laser scanning skid, and there's an INS which would be used with the multi-view, not shown on this image. That is an INS DVL, sprint INS DVL. It could have a cavity blaster, or here we've got a little flapper cleaner. So yeah, quite we feel it's one of our future people. But I'm going to stop clicking through all of the slides and we can watch a video. This sea trials that were conducted soon after, I think it was the beginning of the year, in Nuden, showing the remote sensor, the online display, and then on the right hand side is the bridge controls and the watch. Over there, quite automated, not doing too much, which it should be. There was the AUV. Yes, we initially took it out, of course, in sheltered water, but we also, it was seen a few minutes or a few seconds, we also took it out further. Here we see the ROV, the LARS, the HPU, and also two lifeboats there. I'll talk about them in a second. But then, nice, easy, calm water, but we also took it out to trial a Reson multibeam and compared it to an orbit. We'll see that in a minute. And here, we've got the follow sub with the USB following the ROV. And then, we took it out, as I said, for multibeam. And here we see the online, interesting to see here is because it's a DP vessel, the line turns are really sharp and really quick. But you always want that with a multi-beam, but it is there. And with those trials against the world, we definitely did notice that the the resin has that resolution. The benefit with the Norbit is the ping rate is, they've got dual ping, so that density helps. So, yeah, for the future, we're going to test if the USV can be used to tow equipment, such as side scan sonars. So when I mentioned it first, I said the side scan sonar would be pole mounted. We're soon going to have to also do towed equipment, so like this RTV, or to tow a SV in deeper water, a side scan sonar in deeper water. And AUVs, we believe we could also, smaller AUVs, get a docking system to bring them in. This also is using it as a launch pad for drones, where you can see in this image to inspect wind turbines. Mine hunting, it's actually doing a bit of mine hunting at the moment, and military operations. And when I mentioned earlier the two lifeboats, of course they're there because there's two, you're allowed to have crew on board. But another feature about them is they can be deployed automatically, or sorry, remotely more. So the USV can be used in search and rescue and man overboard operations. But future plans, it's something for another time when we've done some more testing. That's it from me.
Okay, thank you very much again, that was very interesting. I have a couple of questions actually. You've got your onshore base station at Irune, but can you do global operations, or is it going to go to a container base, and are you going to do them, or is it possible for subcontractors or any companies to buy them? Probably there's quite a few questions packed up in that. But, first is it just Irune, or will there be?
There is going to be other, we call them two different names. The one is the ROC, which is the remotely operated control center, and the other one is the ROC is remotely operated center, and it's the center control, which is the one which is similar to Armageddon, but it's also going to be put off in, they've got plans in the Middle East somewhere to have them. But there are 20-foot plan. There's also a 20-foot container at the moment. Only one, but there's a 20-foot container. That's the remote, the one that can go all over the place. So yes, we can containerize that. The reason for containerizing it is sometimes, and certainly at the moment still, ports would prefer somebody there. They don't just want this remote vessel to come alongside and there's nobody really watching it. They want people who can control it with it does have the conning station on the vessel where somebody could sit on it, but it also has a handheld remote so somebody could sit on the key side and steer it out. So some people would prefer, some ports would prefer that we do it that way. So hence we have the containerized remote for the moment.
So just to refer to some presentations we had a few years ago in Ocean Infinity, for example, we were struggling with some of the connectivity, some of the authorization, the bureaucracy. Are you seeing, and you mentioned, alluded to it briefly, are you seeing that things are getting easier now to get these USVs working further offshore without too much paperwork? I mean,
there's always paperwork, but it's still a slow adoption. I think all countries and all bodies are in sort of a watch and see. They're waiting for the other one to make a move and then use that as a model for how to develop this. Nobody's pushing it hard. I think it was nice for Rina. I think they did want to sort of start the ball rolling, so that's why they came to us and asked us to be there first. So, yeah, there are still hurdles.
Tiny steps. Are there any questions from anyone in the audience? Don't be shy. I think that's a very interesting area. There's a lot of different actors in the market at the moment, and I'm also going to put you on the spot and say, well, why do you think you're going to be the one who will win? But I don't think I'll do that. I'll leave that to Professor in everyone's head. So there's a lot of it, and it's very interesting, and we've obviously spent a lot of time developing it. So Thank you very much for your time, Adrian.
Thank you.
Okay, on that note, I'm going to pass you over to the saviour of the day. After that, I only contacted him on Monday. I said he wanted to do this, and he was more than enthusiastic to get involved, and I was very appreciative of that. So, yeah, I will get everything lined up. I didn't see any gremlins in the works in the last one. So, fingers crossed this will be good. I've seen his presentation, and it's very interesting. So, Watler, the floor is yours.
Okay, thank you very much. It's a pleasure to be here. I should actually thank Saab. They are the reason for me standing here. They're not here today, so I'm here instead. Okay. I'm going to talk about the Hugin AUV family. I think it's better to do this. Okay. But first, I'm going to say a few words about a new company. I'm a part of it's not a startup really. It's a company that is about 1 week old today, and it's Kongsberg Discovery. It is, it's about 1,000 people, so it's not a small company. We are separated from Kongsberg Maritime. And the reason for doing this is, of course, to focus more on what we do in our sort of business. It's it's all about what is the instrumentation for the ocean, what we do above in the ocean, in the water column, and also below the seafloor. So all the instrumentation that you know so well, single, multi-beam, echosonders, underwater navigation, communication, and so on, that's now in one company called Kongsberg Discovery. It's for you customers, it's business as usual, but we will try to focus even more on new customers. It's basically on the left, let's see the laser. Single beam, multi-beam echosonders. On the right side here, we have echosonders for more scientific use, the EK80 series of echosonders. CTEX is also part of the business, and of course, uncrewed platforms, underwater and above water. Yeah, this is a picture that tells everything. I'm not going to go through this. Because I'm going to talk about the Hugin family, I'm going to start talking about the Hugin standard, but we can see a little bit about the difference between the models here. The new Hugin Edge and the new Hugin Endurance, that are two new members of the Hugin family. The Hugin standard, I call it standard, the Hugin we have been working with so many years, actually more than 30 years right now. This Easter, it was exactly 30 years since we started the first testing. Then we have the Hugin Superior that we have been producing for a couple of years. So, focusing on the Hugin standard, very quickly go through the main instruments, synthetic aperture sonar, EM2040 multi-beam, that's our main sensors. But of course we have laser camera and standard color stills camera. Sub-bottom profiler, different frequencies, three different models of sub-bottom profiler. We have a long list of chemical sensors that we can use. We have a magnetometer. We have surface communication, GPS, Wi-Fi, RF, and iridium in that antenna. And of course, we use the well-known high-cap system, not just for positioning, but also for downlink and uplink of data. Okay, next. Huygens Superior, almost the same, but it's a collection of everything from the top shelf, plus some more features. There are, we have doubled the length of the synthetic aperture sonar receiver, meaning that the range is doubled. And because of this new this new array here, we can also use that as input to the navigation system. That's two difference, the two main difference between the Superior and the Standard. In real life, so to speak, we cover twice as much area per time. Slot is 1,000 meter. To give you some idea of what we can do, we have some numbers here. We can do a football field in about 9 seconds with less than 3x3 centimeter resolution. And all the other examples here, central part of Manhattan, we can do a IKEA store in about 4 minutes, and that's probably good for most men here, I guess. Less than 3x3 centimeter resolution. Never done that before in the IKEA store. Okay, so we can cover a lot of area in a short time with high resolution. So what we can see, this is a camera that you can zoom in with, and you see a bridge over there. It's roughly 500 meters away. So if you zoom in, you can see that there's some persons on that bridge. And if you focus on one of these persons, you can see that he is carrying a mobile phone. And that mobile phone we can spot underwater with acoustics from 500 meters away. That is what we can see underwater. Okay. A little bit about the new Huygens Edge, which is the new Huygens. It's a rather small vehicle. It comes in sort of one package. What you see is what you get. There's not much physical space for integrating other type of sensors. So, but still, it contains multi-beam, Kongsberg M3 high frequency multi-beam under here. You have a compact DVL and also a sub-bottom profiler here. Plus a camera is also integrated as standard. Magnetometer, and we are also now developing a new synthetic aperture sonar. I will show you one picture later, taken by that new sonar that New Heights has. In addition to that, of course, we have a CTD, that's a standard instrumentation, high pop communication, and a fold-up antenna for surface communication. Yeah, forward-looking sonar, as they all have forward-looking sonar for our anti-collision system, of course. So one package, it is 4 meters long. Has batteries for about 24 hours, depending on what kind of work you are doing. Yeah, that's the Huygens Edge. There's a small model of that Huygens Edge on display, so if you like, you can have a look at it. Then I'm going to talk about the Huygens Endurance, which is the newest member of the Huygens family. It's a long vehicle. It's more than 11 meters, weighs 7.5-8 tons. But of course, the advantage here is that it can dive for more than 2 weeks and travel 2,200, 2,400 kilometers in one charge. it collects a whole lot of data, roughly 2 terabytes per day. So it's a challenge, of course, to handle all that data. And the high SAS resolution is the same as for the superior and also the standard, less than 3 by 3 centimeters. So, but because of that, we can do all the other jobs than we can with a standard Hugin or the Hugin Superior. Long range, more than 2 weeks diving time. Instrumentation will be the same as the Hugin Superior with the dual high SAS, also then being able to use the high SAS as navigation input. I'm coming back to that to show you what that really means. Standard in 2040 multi-beam, so bottom profile and camera laser, same as for the Hugin Superior. Only it's a Hugin Superior on steroids, some people say. Okay. This vehicle has fins, stabilizing fins, meaning that it can also travel very slowly and still be a very stable platform. And because of the stability and the ability to go very slowly, you can have extremely high resolution photos or high SAS data. And because you are traveling slowly, the high SAS range will also increase. That's how the math is. The slower you go with the high SAS system, the longer the range you have. Okay. It has almost the same things as the standard or the superior, but there are some new features here. So we will have AIS if you want to use that, even 360 camera, and we are thinking about integrating the MBR, which is the marine broadband radio from CTEX. That's a very powerful radio with a bandwidth of more than 16 megabytes. So that's a very nice radio for offloading some of the data you have collected. Some of the data will be processed in mission, so you will be able to deliver target lists or lists of objects of interest. Yeah. So, why do we use the synthetic aperture sonar as input to the navigation system? Well, if you travel from Stavanger to Wick in Scotland, that's roughly 500 kilometers. And without using any help from the surface, not using any feature navigation or having a preloaded digital model of the area, just using the collected data in real time, we will be able to end up less than 25 to 50 meters off target. And we can only do that by using not just the Doppler log as input, but as I said, using the synthetic aperture sonar as input to our software, the software package. I forgot the name of the software. Sunstar. We call it Sunstar. So I think this is extremely impressive to be able to be no more than 50 meters off target after 500 kilometers underwater. So if you think about this and think, what can you use this for? Well, also outside Wick, there's a wind farm area. It's about 130 kilometers square kilometer. And we are thinking that you can use the Hugin endurance that can dive for more than 2 weeks. You can launch it from shore, and we call this shore-to-shore operations. And in this case, you don't have to have a surface vessel at all. You can do this without burning any fuel at all. You just charge the AUV and you let it go. And because of the high accuracy, your data here will be just as good as if it's done from a surface ship. So you launch it from the shore after programming. If you want to increase the accuracy, of course you can put transponders out there, use sparse navigation techniques, or you can even go to the surface to take a GPS fix. Then you will have a decimeter resolution of the data. So data quality, that's important for us. This is IM2040, and on top of that, we could put laser data. And laser data, that's millimeter resolution. You can measure the height of the anodes on the pipe, if you like, and then calculate the life rest, how much anode you have left before you have to change the anodes. It could look like this. You see that you have a lot of free spans here touching the ground in some spaces here. You can even measure the height of the free spans. You have some rock dumping here. So this is a typical example of what we can produce using EM2040 and laser. This is bathymetric data from the HISA system. Synthetic aperture sonar can produce different type of products, really. So this is a typical bathymetric data. In the center, between here and here, you have EM2040 multi-beam data. You have some overlap in this area here and this area, but from here out to both edges here, it's HISAS bathymetric data. This is from the Oslo Fjord, and you can see all these marks here. And these are from ship trawling. So the Oslo Fjord is full of these marks. So if people are wondering why the cod is disappearing from the Oslo Fjord, well, this might be one of the reasons. I don't know. I'm not the biologist, but it looks like a highway on there. From the HISAS, you can not only have bathymetric data, but this is one pass. It's from a dumping site outside the city of Arendal on the south coast of Norway. It's FFI, Forskningsinstitutt. That has collected the data, and they found roughly 50 or more than 50 ships that was dumped after the Second World War, late autumn 45 and spring 46. There are a lot of examples. Here you have a SAS image, as we call it. And this is a combination of SAS image and also bathymetric data with color scaling. So you can combine the data. Sometimes we do environmental surveys, and during one of the hunts for missing fishing gear, we found this Dornier that sank just after the war. That didn't have any spare parts, so the plane actually sunk. It's between Horten and Tønsberg. Then this image here. It's outside Horten. There you can find U-735. It's a German submarine. And you see the sharpness of the image here. And this is taken with the new harnesses that we are developing for the Hugin edge, new small Hugin edge. And the resolution here is roughly 1.5 by 1.5 centimeters. Range here, roughly 80 meters, and it's one pass. So, data quality. Lobster pots. Looking for, are you looking for your lobster pot? Okay, this is could be the solution. And if you're not sure that this is actually a lobster pot, well, then you can go down there and take a photo of it. Okay. Norwegian salmon, Norwegian lobster, it's called, I guess. Cucumber. And we even found some bones, whale bones. We found the Coast Guard, and they told us that, yes, they had dumped a whale in this area 1.5 years ago. But still, you can see the, we call them slimår in Norwegian. They are having a party here. One feature that I would like to mention is the ability to compare old and new data. We can use EM2040 multibeam, or you can use SAS data, SAS raw data, and we can compare old with new data, and then you can deduct the two data sets from each other, and you can then end up with only the difference between the data. It could be something new, or it could be something that has been removed from the area. Doesn't really matter, it's just plus or minus. So this is just one feature that we can do with the HiSAS system in particular. Then I'm going to mention a few slides about our range of USVs. I guess some of you have already seen the sounder, the 8-meter sounder. But we also have two larger vessels on the drawing board. The sounder has a moon pool where you can install everything from multibeams to high-pack system following ROVs or AUVs to fish finding sonars. Can usually be used as a force multiplier, or you can send it out on its own to look for the fish. It also comes in a more scientific version. We are delivering two of these this summer. And this is a collection of EK80 transducer from 12 or 18 kilohertz up to 333 kilohertz. So this is a this collection of transducers is actually a continuous swoop in frequency from lower than 12 up to higher than 333 kilohertz. So in this way you can measure what kind of fish, the mean size of the fish. You can probably even tell what kind of fish, how many kilos and so on. So used for fish stock estimation. Yeah, this is a powerful tool. In addition to that, you can install here EM2040, 04 or 07 degrees, plus a subbottom profiler. So this is a quite powerful package. The larger USVs we intend to use as carriers or platforms for different type of equipment. It could be a 20-foot container like this with two edge with automated launch and recovery systems. This is a manual launch and recovery, but this is an automated dual large system for the Hugin edge, the small one. All right. That's roughly what I wanted to show you today.
Really lived up to expectation. I'm very impressed. I'm actually don't even know where to start. I've got a couple of questions, but I'm going to ask the audience maybe. There must be some questions off the back of such an interesting presentation. Do I have any? Oh, Matt, I can count on you.
You mentioned about the using satellite navigation. How does that work? Is it using a target that previously coordinated and recognizes it on the way back? Do you have to pass over the same seabed twice?
No, you do not. The question was, how do we use the HISA system as a navigation system, right?
Yes.
Basically, on each side of the AUV, you can sort of focus on certain points, fixed points, and the HISA system is slightly different from a side scan sonar because. You know, when you have a side scan sonar, you are just it's like looking through a hole, you know. But a HISA system has different beams horizontally, and that means that you can observe the same object many times as you pass it. It's like if you're driving a car, you can see a pole, and you can see the pole going like this, and then you measure the range and the angle to this object in three dimensions, and you can use many points on each side of the AUV at the same time. Let's say you have like 30, 40 of these points that you can use as fixed points, and then calculate the range and bearing to this, and you take all these calculations into the Sunstone navigation package. And then you increase the accuracy roughly by a factor of 10. Okay? And that's only available on the superior and the long range endurance.
So can I take it that the HISAS is what you consider to be the most important feature of these? Who gets now? This is
okay. That's a very powerful sonar. It is a sonar. You can use it for collecting bathymetric data. You have out to 500 meter on each side. You have a bathymetric resolution of 20 by 20 or 20 centimeter. So pretty good. Not as good as the M2040, of course, because then we are talking about centimeter resolution. But still, 500 meter to each side, still 20 centimeters.
Can I ask who or what is actually driving such advanced developments of hooking system? I mean, there's not. I can't imagine there are many fish farmers who could charter or want to rent a superior to look for an lobster copper. What's driving this 11 meters? Doesn't come cheap for most subcontractors or companies looking to do. What do you think? What does Confer think is driving this big leap forward?
I think there's many drivers. Of course, people like to make more and more advanced technology. That's of course one driver for most engineers. But of course, you can also save money by using an AUV. Instead of hiring a large vessel with 60 people on board, you can do the area outside a week in less than 10 days, just using an AUV.
So wind farms would appear to be a very natural recipient, and
of course, yeah. Pre-survey where you want to. To take down the cables, you can use sub-bottom profiler in addition to the HISAS or multi-beam. Make a very detailed map, and then you can decide where to bury the cables. And then afterwards, after the installation, of course, you can then survey again, and you can do the comparison between the old and the new maps, okay? And you can see what has changed And of course, this is important not just to see what is happening down there, but to be able to detect if there are any changes to critical infrastructure. Well, we all know that that is very important these days.
But a lot of, and this is going to end up just a conversation between me and you and a couple of microphones, but a lot of the wind farm developments are in their infancy. There's a lot of companies popping up all the time, new name, wanting to develop a wind farm relatively inexperienced. How receptive are they to the use of something like the Superior as opposed to conventional survey platforms?
That's a good question. Some people or companies are quite reluctant to this. Well, of course, if it's shallow water, let's say it's only 30 meters of water depth, then it's probably better to use some of the sounders, if you like. But if you're talking about floating wind farms, then talking maybe down to 150, 200 meters, maybe even more, then it's really efficient to use an AUV like this.
Do you actually have any Superiors made, or is it just, do you actually have a concept vehicle, or are they in production, or I believe they're obviously turnkey in on whatever?
Superiors, we have made roughly 15. And
all the infinity, I see.
And at the moment, we are also building an Endurance.
The large one. Oh, that's the one I made. That's
okay, sure. That's okay.
So it's the one.
Yeah, we are delivering the first Endurance early 24. It's mixing the numbers here. Early next year. Yeah. So it will be in full use probably before the summer next year.
You don't have to answer that one, but is it Ocean Infinity?
I can answer no to that.
Oh, okay. All right. Okay. Is there any questions then off the back yet? Or can you just chat?
Yeah.
No, I'll hear you. Sorry.
Thank you. Speaking of development companies, I'm Neil Olsen from the Offshore. When it comes to the regulatories and application for permits, what's your experience there, both nationally and internationally?
Are you talking about AUVs?
Yeah, AUVs, and especially
USVs. Then I can only refer to what UTEC just said. I guess technology is now leading the way, and the regulatory and the governments, they are behind. So I think it's about time that something is happening, and it has to happen because it's actually happening. So also on the regulatory side, something has to happen. So when it comes to AUVs, there are not many rules and regulations underwater actually. So that's much easier.
Anyone else?
Oh, yeah. Can you say anything about the cost or payment or
cost? What's that?
Can you say anything about the cost, for example, for the endurance and the pay rates compared to a traditional way of doing things?
I think if you I can say that the Endurance you can buy for, depending on the payload, between 15 and 20 million US dollars. Okay, so but if you think about that, and you can use that vehicle for 15 years if you like, if you maintain it properly. And let's say you're using it for 200 days a year, I think it's very easy to see that this calculation is going in the way of using a Hugin Endurance. You will save a lot of money not having to hire in a large surface vessel. So it's just a matter of thinking, let's say more than 3 years, maybe 2 years. And then you will see that the calculation will be positive for the AUV.
Okay, thank you very much. I think we'll
Is there anyone else who have any questions?
I'll be around so you can talk to me anytime.
Yeah. Excellent. Ryan, what we're going to do is take a break. It's really nice outside. I've just been out there. Let's go for 15, 20 minutes. We've got another three presentations, so come back with a drink. See you in a minute.
in underwater equipment rental. And through that 7 years, 5 years that I was there, I managed to work with a lot of good technology, working with OEMs, different sensors from all around the world, looking at how these sensors fit into our ROVs. But at the back of my mind, I was still very frustrated at how slow the industry was moving towards autonomy, especially on the subsea domain. It seemed that there was no alternative at accelerating this whole entire journey. And I wanted to start off my presentation by going into a different space. So let's think about this whole entire underwater inspection in a completely different way, right? So in the past, all asset owners, they don't want anything to happen to their assets. So from a normal human perspective, none of us want to fall sick. Right? We don't want to be healthy, but we don't want to fall sick as well. So there are different ways that you can not fall sick. Your doctor will tell you that in order to not fall sick, you should eat more vitamin C. So that's doing probably serving. And in order to eat more vitamin C, maybe one of the ways that you can do it is to eat an orange. Right? So that's using either a vessel or a USB. Then your doctor also tells you that other than vitamin C, you also need to have some zinc elements into your diet. So that's the second step of what you do. You carry out a certain inspection when you are trying to aid your health. And that we call it as using a ROV. You eat spinach to kind of give yourself that zinc. But when we look at the original problem itself, it's that they don't want to fall sick. So can we skip the step of eating an orange, buying the orange, having farmers have oranges, having a peeler for the orange, growing spinach, eating spinach, and just get to the end point, which is an all-in-one solution at a much faster speed. We see this demand growing in the market, especially in the past few years due to climate change. What we are seeing is that the market is split into two very diverse sectors. One, you have the nearshore operations where a lot of asset owners are still deploying divers or small ROVs to carry out visual inspections. The cost of doing so is very low because the market can be served on a day-to-day basis with service providers very close to shore. On the other end of the spectrum, you will have offshore oil and gas where because of the nature of the environment, people have to spend a lot of money deploying big vessels and a lot of humans out into the oceans. But what if there is a larger and larger gap of asset owners requiring large-scale infrastructure inspections? We are talking about defense end users, renewable end users, coastal protection, all of these coming of greater and greater demand due to climate change. For this kind of infrastructure, the demand and the scale is so high that we cannot afford to use the current way of doing things anymore. And that's where we see the market gap. How do we get the information directly for all this infrastructure at a much faster speed? The BX solution is looking at the total end solution towards the end, which is the combination of hardware, software, reporting, all the way down to the end of analysis. When we started the company 3 years ago, we were quite interested to use off-the-shelf solutions in terms of ROVs. But what we found was that the ROVs of the market was not able to incorporate the latest and fastest GPU and CPUs required for ML learning on the edge. It was also when incorporated with that kind of GPU capabilities, not able to be small enough and cheap enough to be deployed on a large scale basis. So we started building the first system, which is the hardware side of things. By having the ability to build the hardware, gave us the opportunity to redefine how software, reporting, and analysis could be done. Because we no longer had to be locked in to a particular software vendor or particular user interface of each of the different sensors. What BX had developed was a multi-sensor fusion interface that allowed users to be able to draw in 7 different types of sensor data and process all of it in real time for the operator to carry out survey and inspection on a single pass. When they are able to carry out this kind of multi-sensor fusion approach when doing both survey and inspections, the data is also directly routed to a cloud portal that allows them to help the vehicle and their teams learn from every inspection. So on the top right corner, you will see a wind farm cable protection system inspection that we had did. And what we were able to do is to now hashtag and help the vehicle remember what is a monopile, what is a cable protection system, what is a AOT. And with this information, be able to democratize the knowledge that has been stuck within human pilots in the past. So now this knowledge, what we are doing is to accelerate the availability of data and putting them all in the systems to help the vehicle become more intelligent with every dive. I think when we first launched the product to market, everybody was a little bit concerned about whether the hardware was able to achieve what we said it would achieve. And today, we have just completed our first untethered deployment of the vehicle in the Baltics. So the vehicle is now able to operate and carry out various inspections without the need for human operators to control it. Sorry, the image looked a bit bad because there was a lot of debris on the screen. But the vehicle is essentially self-independent. It's able to process information coming from the perception and navigation sensors. We are also able to validate the ability of the vehicle to operate in various sea state conditions. So what we wanted to prove is that the vehicle can work in various ways and current conditions, with the control system actually adapting to how the waves and currents are like at different water depths. So what we experienced on site was that in the splash zone, the vehicle has to do a lot of compensation. And after the splash zone, the vehicle actually doesn't have to compensate as much. Previously, the knowledge of how to tune all these parameters was in the hands of the human pilots that are controlling the vehicles. But if you want to scale up the ability to carry out inspections quickly, then we need to be able to transfer that knowledge scalably into the vehicles that can actually react and think based on the perception of what the vehicle is seeing. We then, using that vehicle, started to carry out some real-world applications of the full process from delivering the software piloting programs, the AI, all the way down to the reporting. And we started from the most basic inspection that any infrastructure owner has to do, which are shore site inspections. And previously, these kind of jobs were done with a combination of two types of contractors. Survey contractors will carry out a 3D mapping of the area around the seabed. If they detect a debris, they will then call in an ROV contractor to carry out the inspection. But the survey operators will usually have a challenge in going past the first row of piles that they were able to see to navigate past the forest of piles behind that first row. There was also a lot of challenges in avoiding the shadows created by all this infrastructure. So in order to overcome these issues, we decided to mount various multi-beams, both downward-looking and forward-looking, to be able to carry out this mapping in real time. So when the vehicle carries out this real-time mapping, we are able to fuse the visual feedback together with the 3D point cloud and present all this geo-reference data into the portal. When we built the first version of the reporting portal, it took us about 1 hour before the asset owner can see both of this information. Today, this time has been cut down to 1 minute. And with this significant reduction in time, the asset owners are now able to make that decision of what to do next a lot faster. With this particular implementation, we accelerated the project schedule by 4 times, and it significantly reduced their cost of implementation because the job can now be done with a single pass. We then repeated this job with the US Coastal Defense Teams, where they were also interested to understand how to maintain their naval infrastructure. So the latest statistics is that you can carry out unknown mapping of an area with 4 piles in 20 minutes. The commander on the site will be able to get all this information and all the information will be geotagged to allow them to see what's the difference that's changing to their infrastructure over time. After we did this inspection, we started getting some inquiries from offshore wind farm operators because the offshore wind farm operators face the challenge of needing to reduce or keep their inspection costs relatively low even as their wind farms become bigger and bigger. So if they were to use the conventional approach of using a large vessel to replicate that project as it scales up 20 to 30 times, their costs will become very, very high. The biggest potential of what they see of autonomous systems is to reduce the need of trained personnel on site having to carry out the inspection, but then to be able to improve the performance over time. So when you have a computer that's constantly learning about what the vehicle is seeing, is now able to carry out detection of objects from a CPS. So I'm just going to play this video. This inspection is autonomously flown, which means that the pilot is not actually carrying out the flying of the vehicle. What the vehicle currently can do is that we are able to carry out ultra-low altitude bottom tracking. So we are able to stay really very close to the seabed, down to 30 to 50 centimeters. And this allows us to get 3D point cloud generation at a very near range, but also get the visual footages to support what the vehicle is seeing in a single pass. The vehicle is recognizing the target using a fusion of both the sonar and the visual footages. Because what we have experienced in the real world is that when you are operating in shallow water, the visibility is usually quite bad. And there's a lot of turbidity that's preventing the traditional computer vision from detecting and helping the vehicle navigate. So what we did was we did a lot of ML on the sonar images to carry out tracking even when you don't have the visibility of the object itself. And the vehicle will then move closer to target in order to get the visual footages. After that initial experiment was done, we then went out to carry out the real world testing of this vehicle on the 3 wind farms. This was the most recent deployment did in Netherlands, where they actually had to carry out inspections of their ecology rock dumps all around the different wind tiles that they have. So what was really helpful to them was that they no longer had to use a larger ROV of a DP2 vessel, which is what they are currently doing today, but to use the BX AUV to deploy off a traditional CTV that they already have on site. And because the BX AUV already has all the intelligence of how they should move around the structure, we can significantly increase the efficiency when operating on site. So instead of spending the time to launch and recover and try to find where we are, we pre-program where the vehicle thinks the monopile is going to be. We use the autonomy to lock onto the target, and we carry out an automated inspection of the whole entire monopile together with the CPS down to the seabed. So although the time that we spend underwater is much lesser compared to the mid-size ROV because of our current size is still quite small, we were still able to get the footages that the wind farm asset owners require out from the infrastructure. And they are already using the platform to label their data and learn more from every inspection. We then scaled that up to floating infrastructure because they also see the same issue. When you only have one single structure, you only have to do it once. Maybe you have 100 monopiles and you have to do it 100 times. But when you have a floating infrastructure, then the amount of infrastructure that you need to inspect now suddenly quadruples or increase by 5 times. And when you have that dense amount of infrastructure, it becomes harder and harder for you to have a large vessel with an ROV to navigate around the infrastructure. So what we wanted to validate is that the autonomy is able to detect, track mobile objects, that we don't have to be limited only to fixed infrastructure. And the vehicle is learning about all of these mooring lines to detect what is considered a good mooring line and a bad mooring line. Right now, the detection is actually quite simple. It's based on the tilt angle and the catenary shape of that infrastructure itself. But what we will be moving forward to do next year will be to work with TWI to look at how we can bring across the knowledge previously in 3.4U inspection into the vehicle as well. So then you can drastically scale up this expertise across all the vehicles operating in the ocean. Same thing, multi-sensor fusion. So for pipelines or piles, we didn't have much of a pipeline that we can see on the seabed. So we started looking for some infrastructure piles. So asset owners, again, have the issue of having a long time that they needed to spend before they can get the information. With this current implementation of having the forward-looking sonar, the visual sensors, and a 3D MPS that's scanning the seabed, we were able to acquire these three types of data sets in 5 minutes without having a trained pilot know what to do. And they were able to carry out the measurements of the physical objects on the seabed, so to know what exactly is the length of the pile, the height of the pile of the seabed, to determine what is the next step that they should be taking. They can also visually see where do all the visual footages that they have previously been collected, how it overlays onto 2D and 3D point clouds. This is not so interesting, but you can basically replicate the behavior across different kinds of infrastructure like vessels. So if you have a lot of vessels to inspect and you want to reduce the time, you get a vehicle to carry out the whole entire mapping of the vessel, and the vehicle will stop when it actually detects an anomalous object. So for this particular example, we were actually detecting a mine-like looking object on the vessel. So we had to train the vehicle up to recognize what is a mine, what's not a mine. And when it detects a mine, it will flag up the alert to the operator to tell it, okay, this is the area on the vessel that you should be looking at. I think when we started working on AUVs, we also got requests to look at how we can scale this up. If an AUV only can carry out the underwater inspection part, how can we increase the efficiency more? And we're very fortunate to be working with our European partner, Subsea Europe, where they also have a USV. And just a couple of, I think last month, we have now validated the concept of a USV and a HAV being operational on site onto a German wind farm. This wind farm, I think, is about 60 kilometers away from shore. And the asset owner was trying to validate that you can launch smaller platforms of their SOVs that are already in the wind farm itself. And what the USV will do will be to carry out the multi-beam survey. And when something is detected on the seabed, the USV and the AUV can communicate. The AUV then can carry out the close-up inspection. But the two operations can be totally independent. So USV can carry out its multi-beam stuff, AUV can carry out our inspection, and both of us will report either back to the mothership or report independently. That's the USV there, and it's like really amazing that all these wind farms are going super big. You don't have to have a very big system in order to operate in the real world. But because we started validating that, then there was also interest in how to scale that up again. There's a lot of like demands on our team. Like every time we achieve a milestone, it's like, can you please like quadruple that? But that's fine. So next year, we will deliver CX, which is a USV. No, actually, I will call it a ASV. So the vehicle is also combining that same principle that BX had, our focus in autonomous operations, to be able to launch and recover our AUV without having the burden of supporting a TMS or the tether, right? Because our vehicle doesn't require any of that. So the requirement on the USV can be significantly lowered. The CX solution has a USV that is equipped with autonomy that has been field validated. So this autonomy has been validated in the ports of Singapore, where we have 1,000 vessels operating in our waters every day. So we needed to be able to do very good object detection. This USV is not built by VX, but they are a partner for what we can offer. And with this combined solution, what we want to do is to reduce the dependency on remote link, such that even when you don't have communication, the vehicles will know exactly what to do. And when you don't have to have that remote link, then you can have a one-to-many vehicles approach to significantly scale up the ability to carry out inspection at large scale, right? So the operator only needs to react when there's an error flag. And you don't need to react, you don't need to control the system as well. You let the vehicle do its thing to achieve the end goal of being able to do everything a lot more efficiently. So these are the specs. If you are interested, please find me for the specs. But essentially, what we are trying to do here is to produce the reliable systems and improve the reliability of the systems through the operational experience that we have had over the years. The current income release vehicle is operational right now in 3 different countries. We have 6 of them roaming in different parts of the world. Next year, we'll also see the launch of our beta system, where we will double the current fighting capability. And if anybody has a vehicle that can do these specs, please let me know, because then I'll buy them off the shelf without having to build this system. But yes, we built it because we cannot find the specs available of this vehicle. So we want to be able to double our current fighting capabilities in hovering modes to be able to deal with the much higher weather conditions that's expected out from our systems today. VX is relatively young, and we are definitely a startup. So we have 16 people. The company is HQ in Singapore. And to produce the current vehicle that we have had, we have been iterating on the design for 25 times before this current vehicle is operational. We really spent a lot of our time developing the autonomous behaviors inside the vehicles. And this is backed with 12 years of data that we have collected from the sonar and cameras, and to collect these kind of data in different environments so that users can actually trust the behaviors that's coming out from these vehicles. The company has some external funding from defense and non-defense end users. We currently serve about 16 end users. And I would just like to end my presentation by saying that today, now is the time. Like what Ed said, the future is now, right? So please contact us if you want to break free from the traditional ways of doing underwater inspections, especially if you are as impatient as me. Thank you.
So you don't believe in autonomy then?
I do.
I'm exhausted after your presentation. I don't think I've got a question. Does anyone have any questions? I mean, it's a fascinating subject, and you obviously love what you're doing as well. You've talked a little bit about next year, but where does this all take you in years to come? I mean, like, if you're in the crystal ball 5 to 6 years, where are you going to be? Because we obviously we need to be paying attention to you.
I think the genesis of BS was to really help accelerate the industry forward to present alternative solutions that allow end users to get their answer of, you know, whether my infrastructure is okay. So I hope that in 5 years, the BX technology is on hundreds of different infrastructure, really shortening that time of how well they know how well their assets are.
We were talking before about fish, like detecting fish nets and things like that. How does it go about doing sprinkler stuff like that?
Yeah. So I asked a question about how AVs can detect fish nets like 4 years ago, because I was like, oh, you know, if there was a fish net, the AV might get caught while carrying out the inspection. But I realized that Okay, so the short answer is that I don't think it's 100% possible to detect phishing as in all cases. But then I also realized that maybe it's not that important that you are detecting the phishing, but thinking about what to do when you are caught in a phishing, and how to develop the operational concepts around autonomy where those things actually come about. So I think there's still a lot of like unsolved questions for how autonomous operations can happen. And I'm definitely interested to drive this conversation with SMEs and also like-minded service contractors.
Very good. I'm sure they want to be using an endurance in the fishnet, so we're giving the $15 to $20 million price tag. So thank you very much for your presentation. Excellent. Thank you very much, Chris. Really interesting. Al Robertson. Go on. So anyone who was at Yale will obviously know that Hal has made some sort of special name for himself for entering the stage, but it's looking fairly boring. Making effort. So now I'm going to have the years. Al from Deep Ocean is going to tell us what's going on with Deep Ocean and how they're going to be approaching the future of AUVs and remotes and everything else.
Terrific. Thanks a lot. Well, that was a great presentation, Grace. How to follow on from that? Where to start? Yeah, I don't think I've got the same amount of energy as you, at least. So I'll start by saying we're talking a lot about robots, and it's all positive, but we should be aware also of there's some potential things to worry about with robots. So I'll start with this, if it works. Work. Here we go. Any questions? I think I've covered it all. Okay, well, I'll give you just a couple more details. Yeah, so starting off, so you've seen our journey there. We've gone from one type of robot to a different type of robot, and the robots are getting cleverer. We want to be making sure that we remain control of these robots because they can go off and do things that we don't want them to do. At least that's what we're doing at the moment. So if you look at this diagram, which is being constructed about our sort of planned ops in the future. You can see our conventional vessel there, and this is still going to be a main part of operations in the shift to remote operations. There's a lot of things that won't be able to be shifted, at least for now, or in the near future. But as part of this, you see the USV that we've got planned in the picture here, and there'll be more said about that later in the presentation. And the company we're working as part of, Remota, I believe there's somebody from Remota here today, so I won't, there you go. So if you've got some questions about Remota, maybe ask this man, but maybe say something about that. And we've got autonomous, or moving towards autonomous operations at least, subsea with the AID, which I presented at Yalo, as you mentioned, Stuart, and I'll say some words about at least the sort of recent developments that we've had here. And yeah, the whole setup is basically looking at optimizing operations and complementing the way we're doing things at the moment, reducing the number of people offshore, as others have covered. So I won't, say the same things again. I'll just plow on into these next slides. So sort of facilitating this whole shift to remote working is obviously the communication setup. And in the past, this wasn't available, or what was available was not adequate. So we've been moving in this direction, and maybe not as far as some, but we've been completing some work in this area and rolling out services from Starlink on vessels, especially in the US, and low Earth orbit satellites. And this is proven effective, and we're getting some good results from this. So Remota, yeah, there's some brief words about this. So Remota, the organization, is composed of Deep Ocean, Solstad Offshore, and Austenshire. And it's basically looking at remote control. So it's like a separate organization that we're looking, not just the ROCs, but just facilitating this remote control element. And it's looking at having permanent manning associated with this. And one of the features is to be able to scale personnel. So if we're looking at operations, different types of remote operations, all in sort of one room or in one sort of linked room, a group of linked rooms, so we can make the most out of the resources that we've got. So if, so that's the thinking behind this. I won't dive too deep into Remota, but there's options to speak more about this with my friend here, and we can provide more information about how we're moving forward with that. But so looking more onto the survey side, given NOSP, major focus on survey. So what are we doing in this area? Well, it's sort of an ongoing project, gradually shifting towards remote survey. And we may not have made as much progress in this area as some, maybe late starters, but now we see that the sort of underlying technology required to make these shifts is really falling into place. And we're a lot further forward than we were a few years ago. So we're able to implement this now. And yeah, we're evaluating different services that we wanted to host within the cloud, and implemented different automated data processing routines. One of my colleagues, I think he's sat at the back, is taking control of this area. It's not me who's in charge here, but as it says on the screen, it's a real drive to reduce the number of people needed to produce the same data sets. Really optimizing operations. I think it's across the industry. It's a real drive in this direction. So the AID, the Autonomous Inspection Drone. So what is this all about? Well, probably many of you have heard all about this again, in other presentations, so I don't dive too deep here, but just a quick bit of background for those of you who are not aware of this development. So this is maybe a bit of a flagship for Deep Ocean in this area. It's an observation class ROV with intelligent behavior and moving more in the direction of autonomy. But at the moment, it's a remote control of the AID from the ROC is sort of the area, the direction we're moving into. And we've got a number of hours and the system is implemented on a vessel at the moment, working on projects at Aker BP. And so it's the project itself, it's partially funded by Aker BP, and it involves the partners that you see on the screen there, Vast with a machine vision camera, Deep Ocean, sort of sitting in the middle of this with our digital twin, able to take control and task this ROV and using our vessels, obviously, and our crew, and then remote onshore to facilitate control from that side. Yep, so you see the vehicle in action here. This is one of the early videos which we've taken when the system was first implemented early this year. So it became operational in 2023 after various testing. It's a number of years this project's been running that we've got to this stage. It's far from a plug and play solution. But now we've got, as you see on screen, 1,350 or probably more, this is from today, and at least 200 hours of remote operation of this. And it's using capabilities such as structure from motion. And the results that we're gaining from the AID is, we're very happy with. And some of my colleagues here, Christopher Johansson, knows a lot more about this project than me. I'm sure he'd be very happy to talk to you about some of the progress made in this project. It's something we're quite happy with. So there's just a few pictures from a recent project here. We're actually taking some of this information over the weekend. So I've been giving Stuart and Ricardo a headache for not getting my presentation to them until the very last minute, which I'm not known for. That's what it looks like on the vessel, the controller, set up with a vast system there. And this is another track line the AID has followed to achieve full coverage to generate a three-dimensional model of its structure. You see this is basically utilizing vast autonomy through the SubSlam system to create these models. So let's let you watch this video for a moment. This shows pictures worth more than words. One thing to add is that we conduct a number of simulated missions before we actually implement these automated missions, and that's using the digital twin system. So some footage within this video from the most recent project, I think there's 10 simulated missions prior to going out and actually completing a mission. An image of sort of taken from the digital twin there. Giving live updates into the digital twin, allowing us to understand the position of the AID and the amount of data we collected. System is increasing efficiency. Low cost system, much more easy to mobilize to a vessel, and reduce the number of people that we need offshore for operation of that system. So, taking a different step away from maybe more oil and gas, there's other areas where we're looking at remote control of different systems, and one area is seabed mining. So, we're working with the company. Deaf Minerals. I sit in an office with them up in Bergen, and they've had a recent campaign, which I think if you look on NRK, there's a bit of an article about this with some video showing the system, the FlexiCore. And if you read ROV Planet or Ocean Robotics Planet, I've recently put an article in there giving a few more details about this system. So I won't go in depth here about this system, but basically seabed remote coring solution. And this system is a number of benefits of using this. So it's in the early stages at the moment with trials of the system. And we had trials up in the Mons Ridge area this year. over 1,000 meters water depth using the system for creating geotechnical sampling, seabed coring. And it's based on a previous remote vehicle, a seabed excavator. And the topside unit is it's a marinized surface system. So we're looking to, over time, control this from our remote operations center and have the minimum number of people offshore involved in these operations, just what we need for launch and recovery and maintaining the system offshore. So really bringing the ops into the ROC along with other things. So another area is, I said in a previous NOSP presentation earlier this year, I'm not a regular, this is about environmental data collection. And this is an area that we're looking at in collaboration with a company, Akroplan Niva, up in Tromsø. And this is more the use of gliders, sailboys, and these guys have already got set up a remote operation center in their base at Tromsø, and working with this Kongsberg Blue Insight system. And they sent these sailboys out to sea for much longer durations. It's at least over a month, maybe up to 3 months. And they're able to monitor in real time back in the HQ there. And so we're looking at how we can combine our strengths with the environmental side, the monitoring the biomass in the ocean and other factors and chemical constituents alongside actual survey and inspection work. And maybe looking at combining ROCs or at least our capabilities. So digital twin side of things. As I said, the digital twin forms sort of the foundation of a lot of the work we're doing here, especially with the AID. We've moved quite far with this. I'm not intimately involved in this project. There's a lot going on in the US with the digital twin and in Norway. And it's used for planning, for simulation, and for real-time monitoring of operations. And this moves beyond sort of maybe the survey and inspection side to sort of live engineering operations, the application of the system. So if this starts up. This video is just showing an example of some project simulation, overboarding some equipment from a vessel. And it proves a useful tool in many aspects. We've been able to make mistakes, if you will, before we go live. And understand the limitations of some of the operations and simulate different sea states as well for operations and capabilities of the equipment being used. So this is more live operations.
Positioning of the structures that will be indicated within the digital twin. There's obviously transducers placed on these structures to give real position. It's given a much greater sense of awareness than we've had the ability to provide in the past.
Yeah, so there's this is reiterating basically some of the application here with the AID. So using this digital twin and basically the assets that we have laid out, as you see on screen there, will give a live view of the AID during operations to give the operators, and then remotely this can be provided to the guys in the ROC and also to their clients. And this is one aspect, boosts into this. This new move in remote operations is also vitally important to keep the clients in mind, and this remote client rep facility providing for survey ops, engineering ops, and inspection ops. If clients are coming off the vessel, they still need the same ability to QC the work that's going on and giving us the okay to move forward and other things. Yeah, so it's an important tool as part of maybe a wider sort of package we're supplying. So last but not least, I'll say something about this USV Ocean Challenger. And obviously some of the previous presentations focusing on USVs, this one here is a USV sort of implanted and starting to build now. So I won't say as much about this, just briefly a few things. And you know, we're bringing some of our own sort of expertise into this and an in-house LAR system that we're developing. So to make it essentially more competitive, able to work in higher sea states with this vehicle, with a world-class vehicle on board. So this, as I refer to with Remota, is also a collaboration between the same three organizations, Solstad, Ostenshow, and Deep Ocean. And it was the USB that you see here was ordered this year, not long ago, in July. It took quite a lot of build-up to this project. And so now the build sort of going ahead, and yeah. So the USV, as I mentioned, would have a world-class vehicle on board, and potentially have survey sensors on board as well. So looking at a diverse range of applications for the system, and it's also operating more as a, in many instances, is a force multiplier. So not alone, maybe contributing to other services that we're offering. And this is not unique to Deep Ocean. This is a standard sort of drivers behind the shift in this direction. As I think was referred to earlier, Hadrian, so I won't go and over all the same things again, but it's pretty obvious, I think, to most people now, the sort of drivers in moving in this direction. So some details of the system is basically 24 meters in length. Planned endurance is between a week and 2 weeks. Battery, hybrid, diesel, electric, and it's also DP. So hopefully, you know, taking on some of the DP roles of manned vessels currently, and electric work class ROV on board, and with limitations of 1,500 meters, so well within North Sea range. And as we already said, this in-house design for launch and recovery system that we'll have on board. So going back to this slide, going back where I started from, so you've seen I've sort of covered these various component parts in the sort of in this direction that we're taking, in line with the title of the presentation, in our journey into this world of remote ops. And hopefully it sheds some light on this, but I know you all probably found the first slide the most enjoyable part of this presentation, at least I did. So yeah, given that, if this works, go for one more time.
Deep Ocean, seeing what they're doing, very, very interesting in the future ahead of us. I have one question, and then I'm sure, I hope some of the people in the audience have a question. We and you, we both come from Plymouth University, having studied surveying. It almost looks like we're surplus to requirements in a world like this. Maybe we should be approaching games, conferences, electronics arts, to put people in those remote, the rock as you call it, and whatever company what you called yours. Do you feel that surveyors still have a part to play in the future, or are we, do we need to go be doing something else?
Well, yeah, definitely, yeah, without a doubt. But it's just going to change the way of working. So for some, it's potentially a difficult shift, because for people used to having blocks of time off, working offshore, doing 12-hour routine, especially if you've got young kids, you know, it's suddenly can change if the rock is near your house. But yeah, so there's I think there's pros and cons to this, and it is a big adaptation. And it's, I think, thankfully for some, it's happening slowly. But one positive thing I see with this is maybe drawing more on the skills, on this, like, sort of the hardcore skills that you've learned in, say, like Plymouth University when we study surveying. Because I know for one, when I went offshore and I sat online, once we got the system running, there wasn't that much to do, or that much, you weren't really drawing on this wealth of knowledge that you've accumulated. So, but in some of the remote ops, there's a lot more planning that needs to be done. There's maybe a lot more thinking that needs to be done. It's not as simple as getting things going. And so, especially with high levels of autonomy, and that goes maybe not just surveyors, but data processors across the sort of board, in my opinion, anyway.
I think it's valid. I think it's a, yeah, there's a, it's certainly going to be a paradigm shift of kind of people that we get offshore. I mean, the intrepidity of not necessarily taking surveys, they're taking people from all walks of life, and then maybe just expecting there's going to be a large turnover. But I hope there's still a future for surveyors in amongst all this. Are there any questions from the audience at all? Surely. Well, they're flawed, completely flawed by your presenting prowess. So I think we'll leave it there. I think we've got one more presentation. If you, should we have a break? 5 to 10 minutes, come back. Only 5 to 10 minutes. And we'll come back for Freddy's finale. Freddy's finale, there you go.
Okay, so now we have the final presentation of the day. I think we have six in total. I think it's been very high quality. And of course, we have Freddie to finish things off. Are you familiar what gobby means in English, by the way? Has anybody told you?
No.
Okay, well, move on. Okay, but anyway, I think everybody knows you. Freddie is here. I'm really keen to see what gobby is in RTS speak. So I'll leave it with you.
Okay, I'm looking forward to the conversation afterwards. Do you know?
You should.
See? Did you know this? She's behind the name, so okay.
Do you want me to tell you? Shall I just tell you?
Yeah,
it's someone with a loud mouth. With a big, if you're someone's gobby, it means that they're going to be a little bit loud.
We can live with that.
Okay.
I feel like I'm disappointed you.
It could have been worse. Nothing sexual.
Right.
Yeah.
Yes, you know, being in an engineering company, it's our job to come up with new stuff. So we came up with this one, the Gobi, the wave charger. Why? First of all, the name. We have Seed, who is the marketing expert. So she came up with this. Everything needs a story, and this is the story. So read carefully. My English is very limited, but I think the conclusion will be that the Gobi is someone that protects someone, the shrimp. Yeah? Okay. Anyway, yeah. Wave power devices have been around for many years. And most of them will be, well, as you see, expensive and very complex. We've seen a few over the years. So this was kind of the background of the concept that we came up with. So the idea was to make something, a low-cost solution, in operation, very simple. I mean, the sea have, there's a lot of energy out there, and it's just find the right way to refine the energy, because it's almost infinite movement of waves, but the problem has always been to capture that energy and turn it into something. I mean, buoys have normally a challenge because most of them are powered by either solar panels or batteries or a combination. If you're going to have enough energy to power whatever requirement you have, a number of sensors, both under and over water, you need a lot of area. I mean, if you're going to have a lot of energy, you need many solar panels and even more batteries. And there's more battery, more weight, bigger size, so on. So the criteria was to be able to power a large number of surface sensors. Going to come back to
to the details of what type of sensors we can use. But also have a system which is scalable. The power requirement will be very different from customer to customer. This is at least what we are anticipating. And we need to reduce the installation cost and not be dependent on large vessels for deployment. I mean, behind every idea, there is a kind of a business plan. So we were trying to, you know, just come up with some potential use of the concept. There's no point of making something if nobody wants it, I think. So one thing in the world of autonomy, that's the buzzword these days. So so charging of underwater drones is definitely a hot topic. And as we see it, you know, the industry is moving towards more and more autonomy, and charging solutions is definitely a requirement in many of the concepts we have looked into. If you're talking about residential RVs and stuff like that, some places will have infrastructure in place, both power and communication, but some places may not have the capacity, and in maybe in newer fields, green fields, there isn't anything. Also for oceanographic and the environmental monitoring solutions, I mean, if you're going to do environmental monitoring in the far north, where it's dark half the year, I think, you know, we think that, you know, something like this is definitely needed. And then you have a lot of other things. But the best thing is zero carbon technology. That's also a buzzword, so now we have that as well. Okay, so how did this start? We've seen the requirement for some time. We have also been working with a different way power concept. So it didn't came from nothing, but as mentioned, we had an idea to make something simple and with something that could survive, basically. So we had an idea of a very simple concept, and then we have this cooperation with the hydrodynamic environment in Stadt Tormtag, which is located up in Morley. And these guys are really clever. They have been working a number of different wave power concepts, so this was not new to them. So ensuring to have these people on board, which can, you know, correct us and give us advice moving forward. So when we talked to them, we said, okay, we will try to make something like this continuous. So basically, this will be an CAPCPPW. But that's, we had to, you know, rectify that to something easier. So the concept design came in place in 22 February, to be more exact. So this was the concept, roughly. Then we started to rectify this to something in the more in the practical world. So the concept we had in mind to start with was to have a piston moving water through a generator or a turbine. And the idea sounded very good in theory, and we did some maths behind it, and yeah, it looked okay. But when we started to do this in real life, then we discovered it took a lot of energy to move the water through the turbines. So, you know, after a while, we did a lot of testing, and then we found out, maybe it wasn't that great idea anyway. So we had to rethink the whole concept. It's Steve who made some of this, so I can blame it on her, but it says Eureka moment number two, I think it is. Yeah. Okay, so we had to rethink the concept. So then the idea came, why not move the generator or turbine through the water column? Also called hydropower in reverse. You have a reverse engineering, so you could reverse something else as well, we thought. Okay, so this was part of the first part of the testing. So we basically 3D printed a turbine and just had a plastic tube and had some water inside and started to, you know, just doing very simple tests. And it worked. So this led to a model that we really could start to test, you know, the details and how it behaved. I'm not sure if you're familiar with the statoil tank, but it's very similar to SINTEF Ocean. It's kind of the same research type of place. Anyway, so we built a model that we could actually test in real life. And this is what it looks like, the first building. So as you can see, the yellow moving part is the turbine, and so we really got some good results. Did a lot of testing up there, and got a lot of answers. Okay, we had something. So then we started the process of patent applications. So now it's patent pending. Nobody have come up with any protests yet. So looks like it's going well. Very good. So we also made animation, just to give you more of an impression of how this could work. Okay, so what's next? We don't know. We just made it. Yeah. Now, well, we have a few ideas, but anyway, it's there seems to be a lot of interest for this, but we need a partnership, we need clients. So we don't have all the answers yet, but I think we've made a good vehicle to develop further. So yeah, any ideas, you know where to find us. Thank you. Just a couple of things while I'm having the microphone. I think Old Cole mentioned that some people have been there before, some haven't. So if anyone wants to have a guided tour inside the premises, feel free to speak to anyone with an RTS t-shirt and someone will show you around if you're interested. I'm also going to test you later with my man. So, now we had a champagne guys last year, so I thought, okay, we'll make a difference with the band. I'm not. I need to have something else, so the band for me is something I really enjoy doing. Some people may never heard the songs before. That's because we made them ourselves. So, and unfortunately, all the lyrics are in Norwegian. But you think of that, you know, it's not. Top 40 music or cover of songs, but it's honest attempt to make something. Okay, Stuart, do you have
a hand? Very good, thank you.
Yeah.
I could actually have a question. I don't know if anyone has a question. Maybe you can start with mine. What are the alternatives for this at the moment, or are there now? I mean, if you're talking about residential systems, is it power from shore to what are the alternatives at the moment, or is there nothing in the market?
There are things in the market. We don't know every technology out there, but there are things there. As it looks, they are very complicated, they are very expensive, or big and bulky. Anyway, we're talking about doing something efficient, cost efficient, and I think we maybe way ahead from the competition.
Of course.
Modest.
One of the things I was thinking about as I was watching this was the marine growth along the cylinder, which the generator. You said before about that at all. You know, on the quiet days, marine growth can build up, and then over time it stops. And so that's, have you thought about that yet?
Yeah, it's. I mean, you have different methods of coating. But obviously, we haven't that much operational experience yet. But I'm sure there will be.
Okay, so we'll get back to them on that. Okay, does anyone have any other questions? Does anybody have any questions? No. Okay, I think we'll wrap it up then. Thank you, Freddie.
Sure. I just have to see.
I just wanted to correct Stuart on his pronunciation. It's Gobi, not Gobi.
That's the difference between English and Norwegian.
Yeah.
Gobi.
Okay. Thank you very much. So that's it for the NOSP presentations. I'd just like to thank all of them, everybody who's come from far and wide to see and to talk. I'd like to bring up all the presenters so that we can have a quick photograph. We actually do have gifts for them as well, but I always forget to get up. But a big thank you from myself as the chairman of the NOSP committee. A big thank you to the guys who helped me put all this together. And a big thank you to Tola and his team for a wonderful event once again. We're only halfway through it. So thank you very much, everyone, for coming. I'm going to hand over to Tora in a minute. We'll do a picture, Tora, and then explain a little bit about what's happening for the rest of the day. But you are free to indoor. Yeah. The bar is open. Thank you.